in addition to what the Honourable Minister responsible for disaster management has alluded to, there are about more than 30 medical personnel sourced from outside the super containment area that are on those boats that are leaving this evening. They will be doing, apart from treatment, also making sure that we reduce the sources of leptospirosis, typhoid, dengue, and diarrheal diseases, which are known to increase in number after any climatic event, especially when after a cyclone. They will also be traveling with support staff that will ensure that we have continuity of service on the ground in these areas that have been hit badly by Tropical Cyclone Harold. We've had five of our nursing stations that have been relatively significantly damaged with the cyclone, being Batulele, two in Kandabu, also in the Lau group, Onelau, and also Lebuka Indaku has been washed away, which is a self-help project which we have been working hand in hand with the villages of Lebuka Indaku and Matuku. Nevertheless, we've made sure that over the last few days we've had continuity of service, as in the case of Lebuka Indaku, which has been washed away. The nurse now resides in Yaroi and is transported daily back to Lebuka Indaku with a team to make sure that we look after Fijians that are in the Lebuka Indaku village. I can assure the public at this moment that all of our health facilities are providing services, they are functional. There are minor damages in some of our bigger health facilities, such as the Unisea Hospital, and also some of our health centers, but there are damages that are purely cosmetic, but functional-wise, they are all functional, including finding other avenues to be able to provide health care in the five nursing stations that have been significantly damaged. And we've been very thankful to the provincial administrators, the district officers, and also the ROCOs and the Turani Koros and the community health workers in identifying other buildings that we can use. We must be mindful of the fact that at this time, if a nursing station is significantly damaged, then therefore obviously quite a significant number of houses within the village would have also been significantly damaged. So we are very mindful of the need for making sure that we provide a service, but also mindful of the fact that everybody is struggling through these difficult times. As I've alluded to, we want to make sure that we identify those who are, have had significant injuries, and so far we have an idea. Fortunately, there has been no there's no large numbers of significant injuries in the Eastern Division, which we are very thankful to. But also at the same time, we want to make sure that we reduce the communicable diseases, as I've alluded to earlier. I would like now to touch on COVID-19. Before then handing over to the Minister for Defence, and if there are any questions, I can answer it later. As of today, we still are at 16 in terms of the number of patients that we have with COVID-19 in the country. There were 21 tests that we did over the last 24 hours, and all of them were negative. And so far, this is now day 6 of the first case and day 3 of the last case, or going on to the fourth day. So it's now nearly 4 days since we've had the last case of COVID-19. In the country. We've done testing, as I've alluded to in one of the earlier press releases that we've had here and press statements. We've had tests that we've done again on those individuals that have had COVID-19. We've done tests again on the first 5 individuals, and they remain positive, even though their symptoms are negative. Globally, as we all begin to see, this is becoming a very significant event, and the pandemic continues to worsen around the globe. There are countries that are beginning to show some improvement, while others have had challenges. And we now have nearly 2 million cases around the world and nearly 115,000 deaths. The case fatality, as I've alluded to in one of the earlier press releases, has gone from 4%, it's now sitting at about nearly 6.2%. There are 200 level countries and territories with cases all around the world. In the Pacific, Fiji, obviously, as we know, have 16 cases. We also have French Polynesia, Guam, New Caledonia, Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, and Papua New Guinea who have had cases. We also have our friends and neighbors in Australia and New Zealand that have cases, but we are pleased to see and note that they're beginning to flatten their curve, so as to speak. In terms of the Fiji situation, as we are aware, we have that cluster of that case based out of Lotoka. We also have a cluster of that case from Nandi, and that one in Nabua and also in La Paz, and now Nabua being from Suva. And we've had to, over the last few days and few weeks, had to make sure that we carry on with our contact tracing and making sure that we don't miss any individual which may be significant in terms of the spread of the disease. We are very grateful that so far we've gone down to the third generation of the spread of the disease for the cluster based out of Lotoka and the cluster based out of Lambasa, which includes the Nambua Muslim League community, which we are watching with purpose. And so far, as I've alluded to, this is now the fourth day in which we haven't had any other significant cases. I would like to just bring it to you something that is of concern. We, at the Nambua Settlement Muslim League, there are 23 houses which are close to the house of the two, the family that was positive in Nambua. Unfortunately, there have been breaches in terms of quarantine within that place, which we find disappointing in terms of people moving in and out of that small cohort of the community. And also, we've also found out that about six of the gentlemen were found outside of there during curfew hours. And again, I want to reiterate, this is so important that we follow the instructions that have been the directives given by government through the advice of the Ministry of Health to be able to contain this disease. This disease, COVID-19, is not a joke. It is a killer. And we all have to play our part. It may be uncomfortable to stay home because we are asked to stay home because of certain restrictions that have been placed, but we must do it. Also want to say that at this time, we're beginning also to reach the 14th day and beginning to clear some of our people that have been in government-designated quarantine facilities. It might be interesting to see that some of our neighbors, just as of recent, as of last week, are beginning to use this same policy that we've had in place since the 24th, I think, I stand to be correct, 24th or 28th of March, which is the using of designated quarantine facilities. So some of them are beginning to come out of that 14-day requirement that's been in place, and they have been asymptomatic, therefore they've been able to be released. Now, we've been talking about these layers of approach, and I want to again reiterate what the layers are, because we've had so many press statements, we've had so many releases, but again, we're beginning to see in the papers that people continue to say they don't understand what it is. So I will again talk about it, because we all need to understand. We have to understand the game plan. Then, and we also know that sometimes in a game that some players will need to be told the game plan many times before they understand it. Number one is the restrictions that have been in place, initially with certain countries, and then now obviously a lot more, and the restrictions in terms of those who are coming in to actually self-quarantine, and then the use of government-designated quarantine facilities. Number two is the reduction and the prevention of ongoing and potential local transmission. And that's why the containment methods that have been done in terms of the Lotoka lockdown, the Suva lockdown, the Soso lockdown, the containment that's happening within Nambua at the moment, this is to prevent local transmission. As I've alluded to, with a cluster based out of the Lotoka case and also the Lambasa case, we've had three generations of spread. We need to stop it. We need to stop it. You may have been aware that there's discussions that have coming out that one particular person was responsible in one high-income country for the progression of the disease into about 5,000 people, because it keeps on going from generation to generation to generation. So that's the other second layer. Then we have the doctors who are in the hospitals in terms of their clinical management. Remember, these 15 cases, the 16 cases that we have, they had symptoms and they had to be treated, just like any other patient needs to be treated in the hospital. And at the moment, they are stable. None of them has needed a ventilator. And the reason for that is because our clinicians on the ground have got a game plan how to look after them to prevent them from getting on a ventilator. The data suggests that all over the world, if anyone gets on a ventilator with COVID-19, on average, 50% of them don't make it. In some countries, up to 80% of them don't make it. So they've done very well to prevent any of these Fijians who have been positive from getting on the ventilator. Number four is the preparedness for surge in clinical cases. And therefore, their preparedness means the provision of isolation facilities outside of the hospitals into those isolation facilities that have been identified. For example, you must have heard about Lambasa College in the north. You must have heard about the things that we're doing around some of the schools and also some of the other community areas that have been given to us. The use of government-designated facilities. That surge is also important. So these are the layers that I would like to talk about that is so important for us to understand. And lastly, all these have a cost. And as I've said, last week, at last count, it was more than 10 million. More than 10 million, as I said. All these have a cost. Putting Fijians into a government-designated quarantine facility has a cost. We have to make sure that they're in a comfortable environment, that it's air-conditioned. They have to make sure that it's in a place that they will feel at home, that they won't want to get out of it because it's uncomfortable. They all have a cost. And who foots the bill? Government foots the bill through the budget appropriated with the COVID-19 budget. Thank you very much.